this whole, this is like Christianity, and this, what we're saying, it's all because of Jesus and his love. It says in Galatians chapter 2:20, Paul said that it's not I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. It's like, imagine myself now, say I committed a capital crime, and you committed a capital crime or something, and you're in jail, and the sentence for your crime is death. And there's a prosecutor, and you're in the jail cell, and the prosecutor continually, day in and day out, comes to your cell and says, I'm going to get you for what you did. You know, say you murdered or something. I'm going to get you for that murder. I'm going to make sure that you spend the rest of your days in prison, and I'm going to make sure you rot. Now, when I'm in that situation, I'm in that cell, is there any rest? Is there any peace? Absolutely not. Even though I could be sleeping, even though I could be hanging out and there's not any noise going around, inside there is just constant torture and turmoil because of the fears and the worries of the consequences of my actions and the punishment that is due me for what I have done. And then one day, in the midst of all this turmoil and junk inside, a man who's so well known for his character and his integrity and his perfection in the community, he comes to my cell and says, hey, I bring you some good news. Well, what possible good news could you have for me? And he says, well, you know so-and-so. And he says, yeah, that guy, he's the most amazing person I've ever met. He was the nicest guy around. I mean, he was successful. He was well-known. He was famous and a man of such character and integrity. Well, he approached the judge on your behalf. And if you accept the terms of this agreement that he came to terms with the judge, you're free to go. In fact, his body's still hanging outside, so you can come see that the price that you deserve has been paid. That's what this is about, is that I did sin. I did screw up. I did make a lot of mistakes. That's what grace is that it sees that. It's not that there's no sin. It's just God brushes it under the carpet. No, there's a price to be paid for our transgression, for us choosing our own righteousness rather than God's righteousness. And the punishment was death, but God didn't want us, his kids, his beloved creation, to go through that punishment. So what does he do? He doesn't send an angel. He doesn't send a servant. He sends the most precious thing that belonged to him. His own son. His son who has been with him forever. The son who always was the only one who truly knew him. The only one that knew everything about him. He sent him into this sin-filled world to die and to suffer the consequences that we deserve. That's what our message is to the world. Hey, do you accept the terms of the agreement? His death, you don't die. If you refuse, though, the terms of this agreement that the judge had with this man, you got to stay in this cell and endure the punishment. But you don't have to. All you have to do is sign your name and say, I agree to this agreement, and you are free to go and live your life without any fear of punishment, without any fear of judgment, because the price has been paid. That man is hanging, and forever he cannot be charged again. The price has been fully paid. And that's what this is all about, that we can rest. That's what this series is about, is that we can rest today because of what Jesus did. And before we get into today's message, We've been looking at the children of Israel going into the promised land, which is our place of rest. And I want you to notice that Moses could not lead the children of Israel into this promised land. In other words, whom the law came through, the law could not bring them into this place of rest. This place of performance, this place of demands on your flesh, of you performing, could not bring you in to this inheritance. In fact, in Romans chapter 4, I'll read this out of here. In Romans chapter 4, verse 13, it says, for the promise that he would be the heir of the world was not to Abraham or to his seed through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. For if those who are of the law are heirs, faith is made void and the promise made of no effect, because the law brings about wrath, for where there is no law, there is no transgression. Therefore, it is of faith that it might be according to grace. So we see that Moses could not lead them into this place of inheritance, because the inheritance that God has given us is not something earned. It's not something merited. It's not something that you can do to obtain. It's either God has given it to you or you have no access to it. And we all have access to this grace through faith, through believing in Jesus, through this faith of something you don't see, and exercising this trust, you enter into your inheritance. And I want you to also notice that when the children of Israel were still enslaved in Egypt to a picture of Satan, when they were in the hand of Egypt and Pharaoh, and it's a picture of us being dead and controlled under the sway of Satan and stuff. Notice that there were 10 miracles that took place, miracles of judgment from God, signs and wonders of judgment, signs and wonders of death and destruction, and not one of those freed them from Egypt. You know, because a lot of times we think what will get someone out of their current situation, maybe you have someone who they're down a road of destruction right now. Their lifestyle is going down a place of destruction. And so we think, because we've been brought up under law, that the way to get them out is to threaten them with the consequences of their decisions, to preach judgment to them of why they should not, because you'll be judged. When we have pictures in the Bible that no miracle or sign of judgment could free them. The freedom that got the children of Israel out of Egypt was the blood of the Lamb. That's what brought freedom. And in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7, it says that God purchased our freedom with the blood of His Son. The blood of this Lamb was a type, a shadow of our Lamb, Jesus, who would shed His blood that would free you. But when the law is brought forth in a setting like this, or in your life, whatever it is, and you are hearing law, you're hearing performance, and what it is a lot of times is we are trying to change, preachers and pastors, we see you guys, we want to help, but instead of preaching Jesus, who's the answer, and His grace, we try to change the old man. We try to get you to modify and change and put under subjection your old man. When the old man is dead and gone, and but the new way is to feed the new man. And when you walk in this newness of life, Jesus' life, Jesus' character shines through. That's what this is all about. Because a lot of people, you know what I wanted, real quick, email questions at churchsc.org. That this is a great idea that came to me, a lot of people have certain questions. Like, I get asked questions all the time. I've been asked, like, why don't you preach more on sin? Or why don't you, and then other people ask me, well, isn't this sin? Isn't that sin? Isn't doing this sin? Why don't you talk about sin, you know, and all this stuff? And we're not going to get into that today. I wanted to, but I realized to really give the answer to that would take too long, and I wouldn't really get into my message. But I thought that was a great opportunity for me to be able to challenge anybody that has questions. There's questions all the time, like, what about the sufferings of Paul? What about Job's sufferings? What about some of the things Jesus said? What about this? What about that? You know, all these different things, you know. So-and-so is a pastor, and he died in a plane accident, and then you say, you know, he's our protector. What about that? You know, what's going on with this and going on with that? So any questions? There's no question that's too hard. I love questions. And most of the time, any question you can ask me, I've already asked myself. I'm hoping I get new questions that I haven't asked myself. That's really, I love to challenge myself, challenge what I believe. Because what I've understood and what you learn from the Bible is that this new covenant is all about righteousness by faith. So the way we walk is by what we believe, not by what we do. Our behavior and our actions in our life follow what you believe. So when I see something in my life that I'm not happy with, I say, the first thing is, what am I believing wrong? And so that's where the challenging yourself and what you believe and why you believe it comes into play. And don't go run to a preacher. Don't go run to this book or this theology. You run to the Bible and you ask the Holy Spirit, reveal this to me, please. Show me. You are the teacher. You are the one that wrote this. you reveal to me the truth behind this. And he will every time. And the, most of the time, you won't like it right away. Because of our pride and our flesh. And it's the pride of knowledge, you know? It's like, I've been living this way for 20 years. And it's been wrong the whole time, you know? Like you know, some of the things I've gone through. I'm talking personally, you know? It's like, I believed a certain way for so long. There's no way. I've been reading this 100 times, and I never saw it. But I never asked. I assumed. It's that pride of knowledge, pride of knowing everything about God. And then you know, someone else comes to you with an idea or something, and no, you're wrong, I'm right. You know, it's like, hey, relax, it's okay. And them being right or wrong has no bearing on your life, okay? You being right or wrong has everything to do about believing correctly. That's why doctrine is extremely important, because doctrine shapes what we believe. And as my wife can attest, for myself, it is the one of the biggest obsession I have, because in the book of James, you know, stepping up here and launching this church isn't a light thing. It's a very serious matter. Like the book of James says, you know, being a teacher of the word is great, but man, you're going under some much stricter judgment. It doesn't mean I can lose my salvation, but what it's referring to is that you are his people. You are his sheep. And he is super protective of you. And so if I start mouthing off things that don't align with Jesus, he's going to remove my influence. I'm still saved. He still loves me and everything. But like in the book of Revelations, a lot of people like to, you know, like try to scare you with the things that Jesus says. But notice who Jesus is talking to in the first couple chapters of Revelations. He says, write this to the messenger of such and such church, Pergamos or whatever. And the messenger, the Greek word is angelos, which refers to an angel, or it can be a messenger, a pastor. Obviously, they're not angels he's writing to. It's the pastor of the church. So that beginning is not written for the sheep. It's written for the shepherds. And if you look at Jesus' rebuke of the shepherds in those scriptures, it's all because you allowed someone in your church who preached the doctrine that I hate. And if you don't change and kick her out, I'm going to remove your lampstand. Now, the lampstand is not his salvation. The lampstand's a picture of the influence, the place where we come together, where Jesus is exalted, where we point to Jesus, and he will remove that. He will take that away because he's looking out for your good. He doesn't want you being led astray. And what's amazing is a lot of these wrong theologies and doctrines that have plagued the people of God for years, today are very minimal. It's interesting that only the truth remains. What I find super interesting is that the church started off with the pure message of God's grace. And wow, the signs and wonders that God wrought through that church. And so because they have kind of dwindled as far as the signs and wonders and the power that was in that church, man says, well, we got to come up for an explanation of why we don't see the signs and wonders anymore. And so they come up with all kinds of ideas. And then, but the whole time they don't realize it's because they are preaching law. The whole time they are disqualifying you because you have sinned. Because you've made mistakes, because you haven't been living right, you haven't been reading your Bible, you haven't been coming to church, you haven't been doing this, you haven't been doing that. So you're sitting there condemning yourself, and when you go to pray to God and ask him for something, do you think it's easy to receive? You are absolutely not in receiving mode. You are not. You are in giving mode. What else do I got to give you so that I can receive from you? And you're ignoring the perfect work of Jesus. That's what rest is. We rest not because we're just, I'm not going to do anything, but because the work has been done. The work has been accomplished. And so because I believe that, the fruit of my right believing is rest. So you can always tell where someone is if they're restless. You know who's the most restless person in existence? Satan. He has no rest. Remember when he appears before God and Job? God says, where do you come from? Walking to and fro throughout the earth, walking to and fro. He's restless. He's in Peter, it says he's walking about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. He's constantly restless. He has no rest. He has no peace. He's constantly working, fighting, trying to scheme and connive and do this and do that. And the people that he's looking to devour are those in that same state. Because right before that verse, Peter says, cast all your cares on him, for he cares for you. So we see that when we're restful, You're in this place where he can't touch you. He can't grab you and pluck you and do what he wants with you. But if you're restless, if you're running around not in rest, not having peace, are you walking in faith? Are you actively believing and laying hold of the truths before us? And the answer would be no. And so today's message is really like I ask myself, okay, I don't want to be one of those that believes with the mind, that knows God's grace mentally. I know about the Bible. I know about God. I know about Jesus. I'm sure I got all these ideas. You know, I can quote scripture to you. I can do this. I can share Jesus with people and tell. But yet in my heart, it's not there. There's no foundation in my heart. There's no true faith in my heart. No true believing that's like a force in my heart that leads me and guides me. I don't want to be one of those that just has mental assent and mental knowledge, but my life looks completely different than what's in my head. You understand? And so the question is, how do we get to that place? Because there's a lot of people that that struggle with this because they understand it so to the point where they know about God's grace. They know God loves them. They know Jesus died for them. Yet their life is a mess. Their life is not a picture of the results of the cross. It's inner turmoil. It's inner. There's no security in their life. There's no peace. There's no joy. There's no love. You know, there's this constant stress. But they know Jesus loves them. So there's a disconnect. If you know Jesus loves you, you wouldn't have this. See, this wouldn't be going on inside. You'd be at peace and rest. Why? Because he loves you. He's in the boat with you. And if he's in the boat, your boat ain't going down. Right? So there's a disconnect there, and that's what it is. It really is because the belief doesn't get down in your heart. There's no real foundation built. And so that's my question today that we're going to answer. Please, I want you to, like each of you, think of a hard question. Maybe one you've had. Some kind of question that you have about anything about the Bible that you really want to know. And I'm not saying I have all the answers, but I hope you bring me a question I haven't asked so I can see it. So let me talk about it. So please, info@churchoc.org, really easy, but please do that. All right, so Hebrews 4, chapter 4, verse 8. For we who have believed do enter that rest. We went over that, cool. 4:11, let us be diligent then to enter that rest, lest anyone fall according to the same example of disobedience. Now, it's interesting is this disobedience that he's referring to is the children of Israel in the wilderness that refused to believe God. And so he says, don't be disobedient. But we teach today our idea of obedience is obedience to God's law, right? A lot of times if you obey God, blessings will follow. Well, then if it was my obedience that was between me and God's blessings, why did Jesus come? Why did Jesus fulfill the cross? Why did he do all that if it was for me to obtain anyways? If it was possible for me to live a life that could receive all of God's best, then Jesus need not come. You see? But because it was impossible. See, the law wasn't given for you to relate to God. The law wasn't given. The commandments weren't given for any other reason than to show how sinful you are. For instance, Mr. Schumann here, he's born and raised by scoundrels, okay? And they are let's start over. He was born and raised. I got a better analogy, okay? So he was born and raised in this alternate universe where they're all really fast drivers, okay? Super fast drivers. Now everybody else around drives at a decent speed. Not dangerous, not endangering the lives of other people. And this road in their main town doesn't have any speed signs. Okay? There's no law that says how fast you go. Alright? So when he is going 120 down the street with little cats running around and stuff that he's barely missing, is there sin there? Yes. He is missing the mark of perfection. That is not safe. That is not good. It's not beneficial. So he's missing the mark. So there is sin there. But if there's not a law telling him how fast to go, how will he ever know that he's sinful? How will he ever know that there is sin until Miss Schumann comes And she installs a speed limit sign that says don't go over 60. So now when he is just being him, again, he can't change who he is. He was born this way, man. He's a speed, he likes to put the pedal to the metal. So he gets out on the road this Thursday and he punches the gas pedal and he's going 120, but this time he sees a speed limit sign and says, wow, I'm breaking that law. Makes him now a transgressor. See, Galatians chapter 3, it says, why was the law given then? For transgressions. In Isaiah 53, it says that Jesus died for our transgressions. I'm sorry. He was pierced for our transgressions and he was crushed for our sin. See, sin is who you are. That's how you were born. The transgressions is you breaking God's law. But the law was given so that you could see that you have transgressed. You would see your need for Jesus. This law wasn't given to bring you into the promised land. This law wasn't given so that you could just obey and be blessed, because the best in the Bible failed. Nobody could except one man, Jesus. And Jesus said in Matthew in the Sermon on the Mount, don't think I came to destroy the law, but I came to fulfill it. Jesus came into this earth to completely fulfill the law. And in Romans 8, it says the righteous requirement of the law has been fulfilled in us. All right? How do we enter into this rest? We know we enter it by believing, right? So how do we change that disconnect from what I know to put it, get it down in my heart? So let's look at that. Now, before you read this, look up here. So we're looking at the children of Israel, because everything that happened there in Hebrews chapter 4 is a parallel for us today. All of those are types and shadows and pictures for us today to follow. And so it's interesting is Moses, my servant, is dead, right? God says, now Joshua, rise up and lead these people into the promised land. Now again, Moses, the law giver, could not bring them into the promised land. But a man named Joshua, which means God is my salvation, a type of Christ, would lead them. And one of the things that God told him as they are about to cross the Jordan. And now one thing about the Jordan, in entering this place of rest, entering this place, like, how do I know it's for me? How do I know I can rest? When God was leading them from the wilderness to this promised land. Now, just real quick, the promised land is paradise, okay? But there are enemies there. There are giants there. But this is a land that God takes care of himself, that you don't have to do it. He takes care of it for you. He provides for you. The buildings and the homes and the wells are already dug. The wealth is there. It's a land flowing with milk and honey, man. It's not like you go to Panda Express and they give you 3 pieces of chicken. This is they load your plate with chicken. I mean, you are filled. There's an abundance there, right? And that's this land. So they're all excited for it. They're all looking forward to it. And so, but to get there, they had to cross the Jordan River. Now, everything, again, is a picture and a shadow for us. What's cool about the Jordan River is that God has them carry the Ark of the Covenant. We talked about that last week at the feet of Jesus, the Ark of the Covenant, the battles of the Lord. Okay? So the priests carry the Ark of the Covenant on their shoulders, and God says, step into the Jordan River, and as soon as the priest's feet touch the Jordan River, rest in the Jordan River, the water will be rolled back all the way to the town called Adam. It's a picture of our judgment, our curse, and everything that Adam's sin brought upon mankind being rolled back all the way to as if it never happened. So what is this crossing? Here's the ark, a picture of Jesus in the Jordan River. The water's gone, and for the children of Israel to pass by on dry land, it's a picture of our baptism in Christ. It's a picture of you and I. In order to enter this place of rest, you got to be a new creation, because the old man does not know rest. The old life doesn't do rest. The old life is running around like a chicken with his head cut off. No peace, no rest. And that's why I share with people, you got to be extremely guarded of your heart and who you allow to influence it. It isn't about not having friends of people in the world, but it's rather not allowing the world to influence your heart. Your heart is extremely precious. And like I was sharing with someone the other day, I said, listen, if this person is too ignorant and cannot see the beauty of Jesus, what the heck can they offer your life? If they can't see the beauty of this man, the Son of God, if they can't see that, what the heck would you ever listen to anything they have to say? I'm not saying don't be friends with them. Love them. Do for them. Be the best friend to them that you can. But don't allow anything into your heart that comes out of their mouth. They are lost and ignorant, man. But now someone with wisdom, someone that sees the beauty of Jesus, be a little more open-minded. Be able to allow someone with wisdom to influence you and check in with the Holy Spirit. But be very cautious what you guard, because they haven't crossed that Jordan River. They don't understand promised land living. They don't understand why you are restful in the midst of chaos. Why you have peace inside when everyone else is fearful and scared. Terrorism, this, or sickness, virus, this and this. And what are you doing? You're walking around saying Psalm 91 to yourself, that it ain't touching me. I got peace in my heart because someone else lives in here that you don't have. And the other thing is, they are under the sway still of the evil. They're like his puppets. According to Ephesians. So, crossing the Jordan River is a picture of our baptism. That's your old man. You see, we were married to Mr. Law. We were all married to him, and there was nothing we could do about it. There was no escaping our marriage to Mr. Law. And he was a very difficult person to be married to, because all he ever did was demand perfection from you. You are falling short here. You are falling short here, and you aren't doing this. You're not doing enough of this. You're not doing this. It's just condemning, condemning, condemning. The only way out of this marriage is death. Can't divorce him. Can't divorce him. There's no such thing. So the only way out of this marriage to Mr. Law is through death. And what does grace do? The law demands. Grace comes and supplies. Grace gives, doesn't demand. Grace gives what's lacking. It doesn't demand from him. So what does grace do? Grace supplied us with that death. Romans chapter 7 says that through the death of Jesus, we have all been dead to the law. Jesus provided us the death to Mr. Law, so that now we died. Our old man isn't just gone, isn't just alive or there. He is completely dead, gone. And that marriage to Mr. Law is done and gone away with. And now we are a new, living, born-again creation, created in the likeness of Jesus, married to him. So when I go back in this marriage to Jesus and I say, Jesus, thank you so much, man. You're awesome. You love me so much. Thank you. I'm going to run over here. I'm strong. I can keep the law now. Because Jesus encouraged me and empowered me. I can keep the law now. And then you go over here and you're like, all right, I'm strong. I'm going to keep the law. Oh, I failed. Jesus, I need your help again, man. I fail. I need your strength. I need your courage. Hey, stay over here. Because when you go over here, you know what the law is designed to do? To stir up that sin that's in your flesh. It's designed so when you come back over here and analyzing yourself and your performance to God, the sin in your flesh is stirred up and causes you to do what you don't want to do. And then you run back over to Jesus, and Jesus is like, yeah, I'm here, bro. Let's do this. Let me live through you, you know? I die for you. It's my grace, and that's it. You know, no flesh involved, none of your own accomplishments, nothing of what you can do. You just trust me. You know, and we stay here for a little bit, get strong. But hey, that's what we're doing. We're staying over here. That's why we're focusing on getting from what's up here down into our heart, so that I stay here and that I see actual fruit of Jesus in my life. I mean, Jesus really does dwell in us. The Spirit of God dwells in us. The Spirit of God in the Old Testament would only fall on them. It was upon them. Today, in the Old Testament, Jesus was on earth. You had to go find him physically. Here, he's in me. He is here. He's a breath away. He's a prayer away. Yeah? All right, cool. So this is what God tells Joshua. And then they cross the Jordan River, the new creation. And then they got circumcised, removing of the flesh. And it's a picture of our circumcision, not made with hands, but with the cutting away of the body of sins that Jesus did on all of us. You're a new creation. That sinful man is dead, just so you know. So leave him dead. Joshua 1:8. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth. But you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written, and for then you will have good success. I didn't fit it in. For then you will make your way prosperous and have good success. All right, so this is what God told Joshua to do. I'm just going to open up. Let's go. It is a Sabbath of solemn rest for you, and you shall afflict your souls. It is a statute forever. And the priest who is anointed and consecrated to minister as a priest in his father's place shall make atonement upon the linen clothes, the holy garments, and he shall make atonement. The woman also with whom a man, we don't need to go there. But that's when he got to meditate, guys. The book of the law sounds fun and interesting, my goodness. Because, and yet that, though, you have to remember, was just a shadow of somebody. See, when Joshua's reading it, they're not really seeing the fullness of what it's all about. It wasn't until we have hindsight, the cross. And now, when I go back and I look at this law, I'm not reading about the rules and laws. I'm reading about Jesus. I'm seeing Jesus in hindsight of the cross in the book of the law. And yet, though, look at this. The power of the shadow, the power of not knowing fully what it means, would make you prosper and have good success. Joshua, you're leading my people into the promised land. This is what you've got to do. Meditate my law day and night. Okay? This lines up with Hebrews 11, which we just read. Let us therefore be diligent to enter that rest. Let's enter that promised land. And Joshua, lest anyone fall according to the same example of disobedience. For the word of God. Oh, can you see the parallel here? Joshua is going into the promised land by meditating this word. And that word meditate is the Hebrew word hagah, which means hagah, whatever, that which means to mutter, to ponder, to think, to speak, to utter. You're running at running these scriptures and these ideas on your mouth, and you're thinking about them, you're pondering them throughout your day. And well, how often did God tell him to do it? Day and night. Does that leave any time out? No, it doesn't. But, I mean, it's up to you. Like, how much do you want to have peace in your heart? Like, how much do you want to have the fruit of God in your life? Then meditate, yeah? Don't allow the world to conform you. Don't allow everyone else's influences telling you what you can do, telling what you can't do, what can't be accomplished, what you can. Hey, just listen to what God has to say. He's the only one. He's the. And see, this is the thing that gets me, is everyone has a blueprint for your life. What it's supposed to look like. What it's supposed to be. For instance, you look at someone gets up here and starts bragging that they work at McDonald's. What are you bragging about? Right? That's kind of how our flesh would, because it's not a high-end job. Who the heck are you? Who are we to say what's good or not? Why do you think you're the one that wrote the blueprint for this person's life? What if God has a purpose for them being there right now? But you're looking at how much wealth he has, how much money and physical. When I say you, I'm not talking to you guys. Okay, we're past that. Good. The people are looking to see how successful you are based on material wealth, based on how much money you make and all that. You know what God looks at? He don't look at that, because the people he calls in the Bible are the ones like Gideon, that is so afraid of everybody around that he does his chores at night in the wine press so nobody could see him. And you know what he says when he shows up? He says, "Hey, Gideon, you mighty man of valor, God is with you." What? Mighty man of valor? I'm in here hiding because I don't want nobody to see me in case I get taken over or whatever. And God called him and only 300 people to defeat the enemies. God don't look at what man looks at. And so that's my point, is don't allow people with their idea of a blueprint influence your life. God wrote your blueprint. God knows what you would love more than anybody. So let him lead you and guide you. Let him be your God and not other people. For the word of God is living. It's alive. These are not just words on a piece of paper. That's one of the things we can start looking at and start thinking, because it's old. I remember friends, they used to be like, "Man, why do you read that thing? It's so old. I mean, times have changed." I'm like, well, that's fun. That's cool. That's one of the things. Don't ever be Mr. Police Officer out there. The world doesn't need more police officers about what someone believes and what someone. They don't need people telling them who's wrong and who's right. But guess what? When their life is a mess and they need prayer and they see you, I'm not saying your life is looking super pretty, but there's fruit there. There's something about you that when you walk in the room, it's like this presence in the room changes. Like, we can't put a finger on it, but I feel like you have an answer. And then when they come to you in need, you're that friend that they can rely on. Let me bring you here. You remember that scripture that you said was old and isn't relevant for today? Yeah, let's go look at that one first. That's what the beauty of God didn't call you to be a lawyer. We're a witness. What does the witness do? Does the witness prove anything? The witness testifies of what they saw. But we want to be Mr. Lawyer out there talking to everybody. Well, no creation. No. God created it this way. This and that. And trying to talk people into believing when God never asked you to do that. God said, testify and witness that Jesus is alive. And what he's done in your life and in my life. And I've got a lot that I can testify about. Every day I got something new that I can share to the world about how Jesus is still alive and in me today. And that's what he called me to witness about. It's not my job to convince you. It's not my job to do anything other than to testify. For the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. Now, check this out. This is why I love, because a lot of times we look at the word and this Christian life as strictly spiritual, right? It strictly deals with your spiritual wealth, your spiritual being. But I want you to read this verse without any bias glasses on. I want you to see what this verse is saying and the power of this word, not just for your spirit and your soul, but taking care of the physical aspect of it too. What does this say? Piercing even to the... I don't know why when I type this, I did a terrible job of typing this out. It's the joints and marrow. Let me ask you something. Is that physical? I think I heard Jackson say yes, and he's absolutely correct. This ain't spiritual, bro. The joints and marrow. So the things in your life that you can't seem to figure out why it appears this way, why something doesn't seem to change, why something in my life is a little off and I've tried everything, the one thing you haven't tried yet that is the answer to that situation is his word. Piercing even to the dividing of joint and marrow. So the very things that you can't reach, the things in your life and in your body that you can't fix, the Word of God does. That's why in Proverbs chapter 4, it says that this Word is medicine to all their flesh. George Mueller said something. He was a preacher in the 1800s, very powerful man, that I would hate to be wrong about names here. Guy I'm thinking of, it's not George Mueller, but I'm pretty sure it's George Mueller. I'm sure there's police people. But George Mueller, he was like, you know what? And God led me to him too because of the way we do church here, right? Like, how many times have I raised an offering? It hasn't happened, right? Because it's like, there's many reasons for that. But the main thing is if God's real, right? Well, then I'll let him know what I need. Right? Like, what can man do for me that God can't do? Right? So, but I didn't realize that was something on our heart that had been there for a long time. And I found God led me to this guy, George Mueller. And back in the 1800s, before they had internet, before they had all these different things, checks and all that. I mean, you're talking 1800s. And he said the same thing. And so this denomination had offered him a job to preach and run their church for that such and such salary. He said, nah. I ain't taking, because back then they did like pew purchases where like you paid for a seat or something like that. But he's like, nah, don't give me a salary. I'll go to God for what I need. You keep your money. And so what he did is he put a little black box in the back of the church. Just left it there. And he said, I'll tell God about my needs. Right? And so he did. And sure enough, the first year God challenged him with this, he had almost triple come in what they offered him in his salary. So the things that, and God brought this man in the 1800s, who was a nobody, brought him all the way to the place where he was taking care of thousands of orphans without ever raising one offering. Every day, thousands of orphans were being fed breakfast, lunch, and dinner without him ever asking a single man for money. There were days he said they had no food in the house, and lunchtime was an hour away. How the heck are we going to feed them? The kids now, they never knew ever that there was any shortage. Because by lunchtime, somehow, some way, with George Mueller on his knees before God, before Jesus, the food and the provision would show up. He would write every prayer request on one side of the notebook, and then on the other side of the notebook, he would write when it was answered. Over 50,000 prayer requests answered throughout his life. And if you were to do the numbers of money, which I was very curious because he wrote very detailed about numbers and the money that came in. And I remember I did the math, like today's dollars, without ever raising a dollar, he had over $60 to $100 million in today's value coming into his life. This is a man that when he was in a boat, right, crossing over to preach somewhere, and there was this gigantic fog that came in. He lived in England, sorry, I never shared that. He lived in England, and so he was crossing wherever, and the boat had stopped, and so he goes up to the captain and says, "Hey, why are we stopped? What's going on?" And he said, "Oh, this fog is too thick. We can't cross now." He said, "Sir, I've never been late for a preaching engagement. Give me 5 minutes. I'm going to talk to Jesus." He goes away, and he kneels and prays to Jesus, comes back up, and says, "Okay, well, how's it look? Fog gone. Continuing our way, never late." See, this is why Jesus, when he would talk with his disciples privately, he would ask them questions like this. "Who do men say I am?" And they would say, "Oh," and all of the men said were wrong. But then he would ask them this, "Who do you say I am?" See, it's all about what you believe. Someone else can't believe for you. And so Jesus is saying, "Who do you say that I am?" Because Jesus calls himself, God calls himself, when Moses said, "Who are you?" God said what? "I am that I am." What do you need? What is it you need? Because God said, "I am." But see, when we don't go to God for what we need, what happens? We go chase it ourselves. So now instead of chasing Jesus, instead of chasing what's good for us, we are chasing the things we think we need. We're chasing after this. We're chasing after that. Fame, status, money, this, good life, fun life, all these different things. And the whole time, Jesus is up here saying, "I'm the only thing that can satisfy you. I'm the only thing that can fill your heart. Come chase after me, and all those things you're chasing after right now will chase after you." See, a lot of people think that, "Oh, if I follow God, I'm going to live poor. I'm going to have nothing. I'm not going to have any fun." I mean, let's look at some of the people in the Bible who fully followed God. They were not poor men. They may have been poor at one time with absolutely nothing. That's because God likes to call you who are nothing and little in the flesh and make you something great. Because then when people ask you, you can't take any credit for yourself. What kind of credit could Gideon take? What kind of credit can David take when he's running for his life every day? Only that God did this. Only God can do this. And George Mueller said, my point being about George Mueller, is that he said he found himself in the best frame of mind, the best physical health. Now, this is in the 1800s. I encourage you guys to go buy his, he's got autobiographies and stuff on him and books. It's like Prayer of Faith, I think is what it's called. It's a phenomenal book written in the 1800s. But he said he would always find himself in the best physical state, the best place of mind after spending time in God's Word. He would wake up in the morning, he would open this Word, he would meditate, he would, whatever it was the Holy Spirit was leading him to. Not every day you're like, "Oh, spiritual birds floating and chirping, you feel good." But you get yourself in the Word. You find one scripture. This isn't about memorizing a chapter. This is about, "Ooh, something stood out to me." Like Ephesians 1:7. That when Josh said that, that really stood out to me, that God purchased my freedom with the blood of his Son. And now throughout your day, you're reminding yourself of that at lunch and throughout work. Just my freedom. And watch what happens. That Word, which is alive and powerful and sharper than any sword, is doing things in your life. It's doing things in your body, and it's also taking care of your thoughts and your heart. So how do we get it from what's up here into our heart? Meditate. Meditate on His Word. And let me explain something. You're always meditating. There's never a moment you're not meditating. Have you ever had a moment where you weren't thinking? No, because in that moment you were thinking that you weren't thinking. You're never not thinking. Your mind is always working. It's always running. And God's saying, fill it with my Word. Replace those thoughts that don't do you any good and replace it with my thoughts, my heart, my things. Is it kind of warm in here? All right. Because this Word, real quick, we'll skip that. But the basically the Word being alive. It's not just words on a paper, it's a person. Actually, I want to read this. It's really fun. I'm going to read this. Revelation 19, verse 11. Now I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he who sat on him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes were like a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. He had a name written that no one knew except himself. He was clothed with a robe dipped in blood. I think we're getting who this is. And his name is called what? John 1 says that the Word was with God, and the Word was. The Word was. So this Word is not just things on a page. It has a purpose. It's a person. And in John 1, 12, 14, something, it says that the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory. What was this glory full of? Grace and truth. See, because there's a lot in this Word. But there's something you're supposed to find in this. It's not a thing, actually. It's a person, Jesus. That's what this is all about, is seeing Jesus in the Scriptures. Hindsight from the cross, looking back and finding Jesus. That's what we meditate today. And look, we can see in Luke 24, then he said to them, Jesus is raised from the dead. Oh, foolish ones and slow of heart to believe. Okay, that's what we're talking about today. How do I fix my slow of heart to believe? How do I get what's just head knowledge into my heart, right? How do I change what I believe? How do I believe right? How do I did that? Well, Jesus is taking care of it. This is what he said. So what does Jesus do? I'm not the Christ of some of these things. And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, the Scriptures, what did Jesus do? He expounded to them in all the Scriptures the things concerning himself. He expounded from the Scriptures, not what the Scriptures, but what they concerned about him. It wasn't just the Scripture, but it was the context of Jesus in the Scripture. See, that's why we see results in the book of Acts, like because it says Philip went and preached Christ to them. And then it says Paul preached Jesus to them. And Paul preached this to, it wasn't methods, it wasn't ideas, it wasn't man's opinion or religion, and pray five times a day, and make sure you pray for an hour a day, and make sure you do this and do that. No, it was preaching Jesus. And what happens when you preach Jesus, and you hear Jesus, is it begins to change you into that image you're seeing by the Holy Spirit. And in Joshua 6, and the Lord said to Joshua, now, before I, can I go like 10 more minutes? Is that okay? Okay, thank you. Before I get here, I want you to see something. Because sometimes we think it can appear like everything's going to be pretty. You know, I start believing. Okay, Josh, like I'm fired up right now, man. Like, I can't wait to get home and find a scripture and meditate this week. You know, like, I'm ready to rock and roll. So you do that. Great. Awesome. You're feeling good. Like, right now, you're fired up inside. Your heart's burning. Like, man, this is Jesus. I love Jesus. And then things get worse. And we're like, oh, maybe I don't believe. Or maybe it's not working. Or maybe, you know, something's not right. And it was reminding me because there was a situation recently where that happened. And I was like, you're missing the point here, is that I'm in peace and rest and trust regardless of the circumstance. Regardless of how things look. For there was a man one time named Jairus, and his daughter was sick and at the point of death. And here comes Jesus getting off a boat. And Jairus was a ruler of a synagogue, and he humbled himself to the point where he ran and fell at Jesus' feet, begging for help. Jesus, come, lay your hands on my daughter, for she's sick and at the point of death. And Jesus said, all right, I'll come, man. I'll come. I'll heal your daughter. Okay. So Jairus believed. Jairus prayed. He's feeling good. Jesus is with him. Jesus is following him to the house. Man, I'm good. I got my answer. Like, I'm feeling really strong and feeling really good right now. Like, right now, y'all are feeling really good. You know, you got it. God spoke to me, I got this. But along the way, a woman with an issue of blood interrupted their journey. And she took hold of healing for herself without Jesus even realizing it. And so, all this is going on. Time is passing. My daughter's sick and dying. And you got time to Take care. Come on, Jesus. You gave me first dibs, man. Let's go. And after he takes care of the woman with the issue of blood, they start walking, and here comes some bearers of bad news. You know their names, Charlie, Randy, Ralph. People in your life that are bearers of bad news. They always see the negative. And I was sharing with somebody, there is no excuse for any Christian to ever be negative about something. How can you be negative about anything when you have the King of the universe on your side? Like, let's put life in context. Let's put everything in context here. How can I be negative or look negatively at one thing in life? I have no right to do that, or else I just don't believe. And then that's really what it is I might know he loves me, but it's not here. Because when it's in here, when something bad happens, you respond like Jesus responds right now. Because here come these bearers of bad news, and they come to Jairus, and they say, Jairus, don't bother Jesus no more. Your daughter's dead. So let me ask you something. From the moment Jairus prayed to Jesus, did things get better or worse? They got worse. Now no longer is he hoping that he heals her, but now she's got to be raised from the dead. We're talking about two very different situations here. And that's the thing, is a lot of times we look at when we start believing it, immediately things are going to change and look pretty. Jesus' life on the outside did not look pretty. He was dealing with the lost, the hurting, the people that society rejected. I mean, he's got storms arising to drown his boat. He's got people picking up stones to stone him. All the religious leaders of the day are rejecting him. He goes to this town and he's got policemen telling him how he's Beelzebub, he's the devil, and this and that. Then he goes over here to the people and he wants to love them and they reject him. Oh, isn't this just Mary's son? Isn't this just Joseph's son? Who is he? Everywhere he's going, rejection, rejection, rejection. It wasn't pretty. But when we look at the inside of Jesus, it's a whole picture, a whole different picture. Everywhere he went, he was cool and calm because he was in control. It doesn't matter how things look. And in Jairus' life, things got worse. And Jesus turns and grabs a hold of him and says, look, do not fear. Only believe. Because Jairus, with men, things are impossible. But with God, all things are possible. Jairus, do not fear, only believe. And you know what's amazing about it is the same Jesus that was over here that answered his prayer and said, I'm coming with you, is the same Jesus that was with him right here when the bad news came. When things looked worse, Jesus wasn't still over there. He will never leave you or forsake you. He is still right here with you. And you know what's interesting is in Isaiah 62, it says that however the children of Israel were in all of their afflictions, God was afflicted with them. When they were under slavery to Egypt, God was under slavery with them. When they traveled, God went in travel mode. When they battled, God went in battle mode. In every mode you are, Jesus isn't somewhere over here. Even though you may have taken your eyes off of him, he never takes his eyes off of you. Peter sank in the water because he got his eyes off of Jesus and on the storms, yet Jesus' eyes never left Peter, which is why his arm was there before Peter even cried out to him. He was there to save him, to lift him up, and he says, don't fear, only believe. Keep believing, I'm here. The answer is not an event, it's not a situation, it's a person. And as long as you have Jesus, no fear, guys. Just believe. And Jesus went into that room, and all the people that were wailing and crying because the girl said he kicked them out, get out of here, brings in Peter, James, and John. Why? Because Peter represents the stone, James represents the supplanter, and John's name is Grace. That the stone, the law, has been replaced by grace. Brings them in there, and then Jairus and his wife, and he raises her from the dead and says, give her something to eat. Don't tell anybody what happened. He wasn't showing off. He did this because he loved him. He wasn't out there to get more followers. He didn't do this for any other reason than he loved him. That he loved Jairus' daughter. And every situation, Jesus appeared. And we see here Joshua about to go into Jericho. And Jesus appears with the sword drawn. And I want you to see, this is where I'm ending. And the Lord said to Joshua, see, I have given Jericho into your hand, its king, and the mighty men of valor. Now, I got a situation with that, God, because no, I don't see that. I mean, I'm looking over there at Jericho, and I see its walls are very much still standing. I mean, those archers look pretty intimidating on those walls. In fact, what is an arrow? You know, it's like, no, what do you mean, God? But I think it's because God is pointing out when the victory took place. We think the victory takes place when the walls fall. The victory took place when they crossed the Jordan River. I don't think you're following. Why are we free? Is it because you feel free? No, it's because your freedom was purchased with his blood. Victory is not an event. It was a person named Jesus. And that's why Jesus shows up with his sword drawn, and his instructions are not to fight. What are his instructions? See, the thing is, in this life of this rest, there are giants there. There are issues, but catch this. They did not wait. Oh, I love this. Because I used to be under the assumption that I couldn't enjoy God's best until I had fully conquered all my giants in life, right? You kind of have that idea of, you've had that before, like you got to get to this level before you can enjoy God's blessings. Well, let me ask you something. How many Jerichos and cities were destroyed before they began to eat of the fruit of the promised land? It says that as soon as they crossed the Jordan River, they began to eat and partake of the blessings. Jericho hadn't fallen yet. Because it's not something earned. This is a place, and in this place, God says, I'm bringing you to people that are bigger and mightier than you, not so you can fight. This isn't your battle. This isn't for you to take arms and say, ah, look at me. This is for me to give them in your hand. And he says, see, I have given you Jericho. So this isn't a natural sight. This isn't something you physically see. This is from your heart. I believe, God, yes. And that was Joshua and Caleb, man. They believed 40 years ago when everyone else said no. And look what he says. He says, you shall march around the city, all you men of war. You shall go all around the city once. This you shall do 6 days. And now we see numbers in the Bible are very important. 6, the number of man. 1, the number of unity. 7, the number of perfection and completeness and rest. In fact, we see, like we'll talk about next week, about is our spiritual warfare, so the battles that we fight today. When you look at Samson was born, his father's name, it comes from the root word rest. Samson is fruit of rest. How many locks did Samson have in his hair? He had 7. The strength from Samson wasn't because he had long hair. Grow your hair out. Let's see if you get some supernatural strength. It has nothing to do with that. He took the Nazarite vow, and he had 7 locks of hair, all representing rest. What was the devil after Samson? It's after Samson's rest, right? Okay, that's next week. We're on 6 days. You shall march around the city and blow the ram's horn once. Now, let me just paint the picture for you. So you got the soldiers going here. You got the priests blowing the ram's horn. You got the ark. See, just everywhere you go, Jesus goes. They're carrying victory with them. And what does the ram's horn being blown represent? It represents that an innocent had died, blood had been shed for the guilty party. How did I start the message off tonight? Talking about you in jail, someone else paid the price, you're free to go. So their victory wasn't an event. Their victory was from blowing the ram's horn, showing that blood had been shed. And here's Jesus behind him for 6 days. He'll march around once. And you got to imagine what the people of Jericho are thinking. Actually, we do know what they were thinking, because you remember Rahab, the harlot? She said that as soon as we heard about your God and what he did to Egypt 40 years ago. So when God was leading them to the promised land 40 years earlier, the people said, they are much bigger than us. We're like grasshoppers. But you know what? In their houses, they were afraid of Israel. See, the whole time, you're afraid of them. Because you're looking at it wrong. You're not looking at the context of Jesus. But the whole time, they are afraid of you. I found that really interesting when I saw that. Okay? So, here they marched around 6 times. And on the 7th day, Sabbath day. It's God rested on the seventh day, not because he was tired. God never gets tired. It's because everything had been finished. You see, all these are shadows and pictures. This land is a land of rest. And on the seventh day, the day of rest, where you do no work, you shall march around seven times, and the priest shall blow the trumpets, and it shall come to pass. It shall come to pass that when they make a long blast with the ram's horn, and when you hear the sound of the trumpet, that all the people shall shout. What has it been our verse the last couple weeks? Isaiah 54. Cry aloud, O barren woman, you who have not born, shout, sing. Question. Who's doing the blowing of the trumpets? It's the priests. So it's the people. I'm spitting a lot. The people that are marching, the soldiers, you, what are they hearing with their ears for six straight days? And then on the seventh day, seven times, what have they been meditating on? It says the ram's horn, right? They've been hearing it over and over and over. And what does the ram's horn represent? Your sins are covered. Your sins are gone. God is on your side because there is nothing in between you and God. The innocent has died for the guilty. Your sins are covered. It's a picture of Jesus and the cross and his blood that was shed. And guess what? Today for us, our sins are not just covered. Our sins are gone, wiped away. It is not just an atonement. It is a complete removal of all your sin because of Jesus and how perfect of a sacrifice he was, that when he fully finished purging our sins, he sat down at the right hand of God, praying for you and I. And that's what the people, the armies heard. See, we think, I got to go do something. No, God says, you got to hear the ram's horn be blown. And then you shout your victory. I don't think we're getting this, guys. These people are hearing the ram's horn. What are you hearing? That's my point. What are you listening to? Are you hearing and meditating on the ram's horn? On Jesus? Because that's what caused the walls to fall. It wasn't some extra effort from them. In fact, the soldiers did nothing but march. That's all they did. And then they shouted. They shouted. You know what happens? Jesus said, out of the abundance of your heart, your mouth speaks. So I can see that what I believe, when I'm truly believing from my heart, it'll start coming out of my mouth. And I'm not going to think about it. That's when you know it's gotten down there. When you start speaking a little differently. You start thinking differently. And those thoughts aren't being produced from out here, but from your heart. And when you get to that place, you get pretty excited about life. You start shouting. You start rejoicing. And they're saying, why are you so excited? See, Jericho was given to me. They say, no, I don't see. I don't see that. But you see something differently. The eye of faith from your heart. And I want to close. Therefore, he who supplies the Spirit to you and works miracles among you, does he do it by the works of law or by the what? Hearing of faith. The soldiers marching around Jericho, what were they hearing? Someone died for them. The death has been done. Victory is mine. Not because I deserve it. Not because I'm a good warrior or I've been obedient. No, because I've been disobedient and I don't deserve it, that he died for me in my place. So I'm going to honor God by honoring his son and believing in that sacrifice. I'm not going to receive his grace in vain. I'm not going to have all this grace on my life and still go out and try to be somebody, do something when God says you already are somebody. God says, I've already made you in my son's image. You've been reborn not because of you, but because of him. See, all day today you've been hearing the ram's horn being blown. The ram's horn. And you continue. Look at, he said, it shall come to pass. It shall come to pass. Jesus, don't fear, just believe. It shall come to pass. What is it? It shall come to pass. Keep hearing the ram's horn blown. Keep resting. Keep resting. In 2 Corinthians, but we all with unveiled face beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, adjusted by the Spirit of the Lord. What does Jesus look like today? Jesus looks young. He looks like, man, I mean, he's a beast. Beautiful, wonderful, righteous, healthy, strong, loving, caring. He's everything perfect. And the scripture says, the more I behold him in his glory, the more the Holy Spirit transforms me into that image. But maybe transformation hasn't been happening because we've been trying to modify and change your old man instead of allowing the Holy Spirit to transform the new man. And perhaps we haven't been experiencing transformation because we haven't been giving him the substance by which he transforms, which is the glory of the Lord and what he's accomplished. That's why this is all about preaching Jesus. That's why this isn't about methods. This isn't about things for you to go do, but rather this teaching on meditating his word in context of Jesus and his resurrection is something that is actually true. And you're going to be meditating on things anyways. You're constantly thinking anyways. You're either meditating on the disasters and the storms of life, or you can meditate on Jesus and his word. And though things may look and get worse, Jesus says, don't fear, only believe, because I am your victory. It's not an event, it's a person. And you know, the ram's horn is proclaiming that the ram had died. And as we partake communion, Paul said in 1 Corinthians that this, when you partake of Holy Communion, you are proclaiming the Lord's death till he comes. You are proclaiming his death till he comes every time you partake of this. So let's all stand, shall we? And you can partake whenever you want during the worship. And I want you to make this personal with the Lord. It's a very intimate thing to partake of his body and his blood. And just to remind us, Jesus, on that night, he said, this is something I've been looking forward to do with you guys for a long time. He said, I want you to see that this bread, which was broken for you, it wasn't actually that one-year-old lamb that was slain in the wilderness or in Egypt that freed you. That was just a picture of me. And this body is about to be broken for you. I'm about to be scourged. I'm about to be whipped. I'm about to be mocked and insulted and bruised and crushed on your behalf. And every time you partake in the Lord's bread, discerning the Lord's body, why did he go through those things? That's what we look at. Not just that he did, but why? There is purpose behind it. Why did he bleed in the Garden of Gethsemane? Why did he sweat drops of blood? Everything there is purposeful. And it's because when he bled drops of blood into that ground, he redeemed us from the sweat and toil of life. And when he was whipped and scourged, Isaiah 53 says, by his stripes we are healed. He was crushed and pierced for our transgressions and our sins. Those nails in his hands were so that we could be forgiven. And the blood that gushed from his side was so that the church could be born. That's you and I. So I want you to remember them, remember him, and as we worship with the song, feel free to partake in. This blood is your freedom. The blood of Jesus is what has set us free. From whatever may be holding you, it's the blood. Thank you, Jesus.